And we're now joined by political scientist Clive Arguelles. Good morning, Clive.
Good morning, Katrina. Thank you for having me today.
Glad to have you here. President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. earlier agreed to the incomplete grade an analyst gave him for his first year in office. Would you agree with that?
I would actually also say that he probably deserved that incomplete grade. I think when we consider his key domestic policies or key domestic promises that he made during the campaign period, and looking into it a year after, much of it has yet to be delivered and experienced by ordinary Filipinos. For example, in the key issue of reducing the prices of basic food commodities, we have really yet to see that happening. And we, you know, I can actually say that the president has really under-delivered, made a disappointing performance on that policy alone.
Okay, which policy were you talking about? The rise in the price of commodities? Would it be fair to blame the president over that issue, considering that there have been international headwinds in the past months?
Yes, I think the rise, the inflation, is something that our neighbors in the region are also experiencing, and other countries as well outside the region. But we've also seen that our neighbors, particularly in the Southeast Asian region, have been able to respond more effectively and efficiently. We haven't seen, for example, the price of such a basic food commodity like onion, like its price rise the way that it did in the Philippines. We've also been seeing that despite the inflation, this particular challenge that is shared across different countries, the responses of the government have been different. And that is how we're actually assessing this administration.
Okay, the price of gas and urea across many countries have risen due to the conflict between Russia and Ukraine. What could the president have done in the past months for him to better insulate the Philippines from these instabilities?
Right, yeah. So when it comes to the price of fuel, and as we know, this caused a domino effect on all the other prices in the domestic market. We expect the national government to institute relief policies related to relief on the average Filipinos. For example, the value-added tax on the fuel. There were also some proposals to distribute cash transfers to low-income families just to help them cope with the rising prices as a result of the rising fuel prices. So I would say that there is an opportunity for a whole of society, whole of government approach that wasn't really taken advantage of by the administration. There were some efforts. There's this Kadiwa store, but these are pockets of reliefs rather than really a national targeted effort to help ordinary Filipinos cope with these global challenges. And definitely it's the responsibility of the government to help its citizens cope with these global challenges.
All right. Clive, WR Numero Research is known for building data and evidence tools. Now, what are the numbers telling you? How is the performance of the president in his first year of power if we base it on actual data?
Right. Yeah, I think President Marcos would be happy to hear that he remains popular and he remains supported by most Filipinos. The numbers that we are seeing in WR Numero is also quite the same with what we have been seeing with other polling firms that has already been made public, and that is that he remains popular in his first year in power. And this is something that is not unusual for any president, any Philippine president, in their first year of power. They usually enjoy a good honeymoon period with Filipino voters. And I think that also extends to this president, President Marcos Jr.
There has been much criticism about having a meek opposition in the past few months. What do you think is the root cause of the weak opposition that we see nowadays? Is it because of the popularity of the president, or is it because there is little to criticize about the current administration? What's the logic behind there?
Right. Yeah, I think there are definitely many different factors why we are still seeing a weak political opposition in the Philippines. But it's weak performance in the past elections definitely contributes to its inability to its inability to currently pose itself as a serious and credible threat to the administration. What we see right now is that serious or threatening opposition actually comes from within the ruling coalition or within the administration rather than from the outside, right? So, for example, when there are key policies, threatening criticisms would actually come from some members of the family of the Marcos themselves, like, for example, Senator Aimee Marcos, or people coming from the administration's ruling coalition, the Vice President Sala Duterte or the former President Gloria Arroyo. And this is the current political dynamics, that what is really the opposition really comes from within the ruling coalition rather than from your traditional political opposition.
Okay, in the past months, the supermajority enjoyed by the president was on the brink of an implosion, particularly in the House of Representatives, but that was quelled. What does that say about the president's coalition that he built in the first year?
Right. So any huge coalition is bound to experience these kinds of ruptures and these kinds of challenges. And I think this is one among the many tests that this coalition will face as we progress into the Marcos Jr. administration, especially as we near the midterm elections and many of the members of this huge coalition have local political stakes. I think, the tensions will continue to escalate, because although there's much national power that can be shared between members of the ruling coalition, just as, for example, President Marcos Jr. and Vice President Sara Duterte, the reality at the ground is different. There's very little political power that can be shared among many members of the ruling coalition. So it's a test of who really has the influence of the president, who really enjoys the support of the president, the one sitting in Malacanang. And I think the tensions in the coalition has something to do with this.
Does this mean that the president should actually brace for more low-level skirmishes within his coalition in the coming months?
I think yes. I think we've already been seeing it. If you've observed, there have been new parties, right, that have been created most recently. And these are also people who are technically part of the ruling coalition, and you now have maybe five parties proclaiming themselves to all be loyal to the president. So I think from today to the coming weeks and coming months, the challenge for President Marcos is to strategically make a choice, right? Which of these new local parties or the existing ruling party will he give his support to? And definitely, this will affect the chances of the ruling coalition in the midterm elections, and of course, the relationship of the different key political players in the administration.
All right, Cleve, let's now talk about the president's programs in his first year in office. What agency or program had a sterling performance in their freshman year?
Yeah, I think it would be the Foreign Affairs Department and the allied agencies of Foreign Affairs, those who are involved in the foreign policy. I think I am very happy to see that we have taken a more active stage in the international community again. I think we are a big country in a very geopolitically dynamic region, and therefore our voice must always be present in any of the conversations about the future of the international community. And I'm glad to see that the president is really enthusiastic in taking part in these international conversations, especially that we're coming from the from an administration of Rodrigo Duterte, the past administration, which really refused to take part in these conversations.
Exactly, which leads me to my next question, the president's foreign policy. How effective has that been? First, let's talk about in terms of economic partnerships.
Well, when it comes to when it comes to foreign policy, it usually will take a while before we see the benefits, before we get to reap any economic benefits from these trips, for example, of the president. We've seen that the president has received pledges But we have to be very cautious, because in the past administration, we've experienced what we call the pledge trap, right? So we've received so many pledges, investment pledges, but they weren't really realized before the end of that administration. So I think what President Marcos should focus on, aside from really collecting these pledges and being part of this international conversation, is to make sure, right, that at the background, these pledges will turn into actual economic investments.
The president has much been criticized about traveling too frequently to international destinations, to international meetings. Do you think that it's time for the president to take a pause to actually sit down and make sure that these pledges are turned into actual investments?
Right. So I think there, if I'm correct, the last number that I've seen, he made 13 foreign trips out of the first 12 months in power. So that's definitely a lot. And I think before I answer your question, Kat, I think this is, you know, it's very important to mention that this is also not, this is not only because the president is, you know, the president wants the Philippines to be active in the international stage, but this is also something about the political baggage of the Marcos family, right? They were humiliated in the international community when their father was deposed during the martial law years. And I think this, they're taking this opportunity to also rehabilitate and restore their name in the international stage now that their names have been restored in the Philippines, right? So this is also something that's quite political, and if I may say so, my observation also personal for a member of the Marcos family. So I don't think this is going to stop anytime soon. I think they will really use this opportunity. They've waited for several decades to be able to be back in the international spotlight. So I think they will use that opportunity to the best that they can. And I think it's the foreign policy is really part of the responsibility of a Philippine president. What I would suggest is that I think that these foreign trips should also coincide with making sure that the domestic policy is also in order, that his house, that the Philippines is also in order. I think that's where the concern is coming from, that the president cannot be, you know, making these foreign trips without making sure that the lives of everyday Filipinos are actually going well.
Since this the number of his foreign trips have been quite controversial, let's talk about other controversies that happened in the first year. What would you say had the worst impact on the administration?
I think the Maharlika that they've spent so much political capital and energies on the Maharlika fund, to me, will have long-term consequences to the legitimacy and to the popularity of this administration. The president made several promises that his administration, I think this, you know, during the campaign and even in the State of the Nation address, that this administration will be serious in its anti-corruption efforts. And definitely the Filipinos and the rest of the world is, you know, we're actually observing the president that, given their record, given the family's record, right? But it's not inspiring confidence that the administration chose to spend its political energies for the first year to sign into law a no audit and slush fund like a Maharlika fund. There are so many concerns about it, not only about its economic performance, but that it's very vulnerable to massive corruption. And no less than the Senator Aimee Marcos, the sister of the president, already pointed this out, that this huge fund is actually very vulnerable to corruption.
Mm-hmm. And what about the president's take on China? He has been treading a thin line over there. We are seeing China playing a two-faced strategy. On one hand, you have Xi Jinping inviting the president for a state visit to Beijing earlier this year. But then on the other hand, you have Chinese vessels continuously harassing Filipino fishermen and even Filipino officials in the West Philippine Sea. What can you say about the Marcos administration's way of dealing with the Philippines' rights in the West Philippine Sea during his first year in office?
Yeah, I think given our limited capabilities, but definitely sizable influence in the international community, I think that maintaining an open relationship of dialogue with the Chinese government, but definitely not, but definitely continuing our open protests as well on their activities, on their incursions in our territory in the West Philippine Sea. I think this strategy is definitely welcome. I think this is something that we are very well placed to do, given the restraints or constraints, rather, given the constraints that we have. I know that for us Filipinos, we have, you know, we want to see more action on the West Philippine Sea. But I also think that it's very important that we balance our strategy on what we are currently capable of, and definitely how the rest of the region and the world is shaping, given the changing dynamics, for example, between U.S. and the United States. It's definitely important, and I think that the president is in the right direction, that we're balancing these relationships with these with the superpower like the United States, our close ally, but also maintaining an open relationship with an emerging superpower, that of the China.
Okay, another controversy faced by President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. in his first year in power is the appointment of a debarred lawyer Larry Gadon, as his presidential advisor for poverty alleviation. Do you think that would create a ripple effect against the president's popularity?
I don't think so. I don't think it will negatively affect his popularity among voters. But I'm very sure that it doesn't inspire confidence among those who are observing Philippine politics. You know, those in the business, those in the civil society, for example. Because at the end of the day, all presidential appointments, as we know, are considered alter ego of the president. It is as if they're also the president themselves, right? So it says so much that the president is willing to use his presidential appointment powers to appoint a disgraced and disbarred lawyer like Larry Gadon.
And on the other end of the spectrum, who would you say is the president's best pick inside his cabinet?
Yeah, I think aside from the much celebrated appointment of the economic managers, I think that the appointment of Secretary Gilbert Teodoro as the Secretary for National Defense is also welcome in many circles, given that he has the technical expertise and competence to actually exercise the duties of being Secretary of National Defense, but also the political capital to be able to bring the different political players in one table, and that's a very important consideration for this particular post. Especially that one of his key marching orders, as we've heard from Secretary Teodoro, is to actually resolve this issue about the military pension, right? And I think it's very important that a veteran cabinet member, just as Secretary Teodoro, is on top of this. And lastly, I also think that it's very important that we have finally appointed another civilian to head the defense establishment. I think this is good that we've returned to that important idea that the defense establishment should be headed by a civilian. I think it took President Marcos several months before making this appointment, but I'm happy to finally see you.
Okay, the appointment of Gibo Teodoro to the Department of National Defense came alongside the appointment of Ted Herbosa to the Department of Health, which leaves the Department of Agriculture as the lone major government agency that has yet to have a full-fledged secretary. Would you say that it's now time for the president to let go of that portfolio and appoint a secretary for the Department of Agriculture?
Yeah, I think he should have let go of that post, yesterday. It's very disappointing that the Department of Agriculture has yet to have its own secretary. On the one hand, the president thinks that because he is serving as the de facto secretary, that means that the entire power of Malacanang and the entire power of his office is dedicated to agriculture. But that also means that the Department of Agriculture and all its responsibilities is competing with all of the many responsibilities that the president has to fulfill. So that's going to be a concern. And because of that, we've seen underperformance in terms of achieving agriculture-related goals. For example, we've seen problems about supply shortages in flour, in sugar, in other basic food commodities in the past year. And these are issues that a full-time Secretary of Agriculture should be working on 24/7. Now that the president has placed himself in this position, my thinking is that it would be very difficult for him to hand over the secretary position without any clear public victory. I think this is the reason why he has yet to name a new secretary of agriculture, despite filling the other important departments with new secretary appointments. I think he can't leave the Department of Agriculture without being able to claim for the public and for his supporters that he has made a remarkable achievement in that portfolio.
All right. And before we let you go, Cleve, sauna season coming up in a few weeks. The president set to deliver his second State of the Nation address before members of Congress by the fourth Monday of July. What do you expect the chief executive to include in that speech?
I think president will definitely talk about what he has supposedly achieved in his first year of power. There are initiatives that they focus on that they were able to gain the support of the Congress, particularly the Maharlika, for example. I think that that will be central to the president's address. But as a political observer, I'm also quite interested what the president will say or what he will signal about the upcoming midterm elections, especially that the 2024 budget, which is going to be decided this year by the Congress, is actually usually what's important for those who will be running for the 2025 midterm elections. So I'll be very interested to hear what kinds of signal the president will send about his allies and who would be his allies in this coming local elections.
All right. Thank you so much for joining us this morning and sharing your insights, political analyst Cleve Arguelles.
Marami pong salamat.